Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for taking this time to join us in our Lunch and Learn in September 2021. My name is Hugo Rodriguez. I'm a software developer and member of the JobCity HR department. It's really nice to have so many people interested in this topic. Talking about this topic, let me introduce you to Jose. He's an awesome and very skilled developer, and he's working from Quito office. Now, please welcome Jose, who is going to talk about today's service workers.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jose, and as Schubert said, I'm going to talk to you about service workers. So, what are service workers? Service workers are just plain JavaScript that runs on a different thread. Is attached to a global scope. A normal JavaScript is attached to the same scope as our DOM, our HTML files, and everything. But service workers are attached to a global DOM. This means that if a page is closed, the service worker continue working. It only reacts to events. Who uses service workers? So service workers have been used by many big companies like Google or Facebook. Whenever you're using their applications or some other web app, if you have push notifications or offline functionalities, is most likely to this application to be using a service worker. It's not a perfect technology because it's in continuous development. And it also, in order to this to work perfectly, you'll need to know if the browser from your user is has support for service workers. Here you can check if the browser, all the browsers that have support for service workers. Okay, listenable events. So many all the service workers react to events. The most popular event is the fetch event. The fetch event is triggered whenever the browser reaches for CSS files or HTML or JavaScript files. You can think of this as a client-side proxy, which intercepts every request. Okay, push notifications. The service worker reacts for incoming push request for another server. Background synchronization. So service workers some browsers have the ability to store actions that couldn't be processed whenever because of bad internet connection. So a service worker can have access to all these actions that couldn't be processed. And whenever the connection comes right again, comes back again, the service worker could process all these actions. And this could be done also manually using an IndexedDB database from the browser itself. The lifecycle events. So service workers has their own lifecycle events. The installation event run every time you run a page for the first time, and the activation event runs whenever the installation is finished. Okay, this is the lifecycle tree. You can see that either starts with active install event, continues with activation, and whenever the service worker is on long ranges of inactivity, it will enter to an idle or terminate event. This doesn't mean that the service worker is stopped working. This just means that it's saving resources. How do service workers react to events? You can see that in order to react to events, you just use an event listener. This event listener receives two parameters, the name of the event and a callback. The demo I'm going to show you, it's a simple news application. We are going to use the Fetch API from the browser, the lifecycle event, and background synchronization in order to have offline capabilities and everything. You can see here, if I click on Inspect Application, here the Docs application from Google has many service workers running in the background. You can see here that there is a service worker for offline mode, for the main domain, or for the document. So this is this global scope I was talking about. looking at our demo. This is the demo. It's a simple application where you can click on news and check the news. Here is the application itself. It just has some HTML files, an offline file, and some scripts in order to mount all the information. And for the backend, I use a custom server where we just have some endpoints which retrieve data. Okay, so as you can see, in order to have a service worker working, you first need to create a file. This file, I call the file serviceworker.js. So in order to, first we want to react to some events. So let's react to the install event, self.addEventListener, install, because we want to react to the install event, and the callback. Okay. And let's just console log something. Console log the service worker install. Okay. Now, if I go to my page, inspect the page, go to application, and reload the page, you can see that our application is not aware of the service worker. This is because we have to register it. So in order to register the application, I'll choose the app.js file. This is because all the HTML files are important this script. So let's register our service worker. It's pretty simple. First, we have to check if the service worker is available for this browser. So in order to do this, we check for service worker in the navigator object. So if this is correct, we can access the service worker, and the register method. This method receives a path to a file. So let's just add our file. Mine is sw.js. And then this return a promise. We can access the promise with an empty function. Okay. And let's just console log service worker register. Service worker register. Okay. Now if I go to my application and reload the page, you can see that now we are receiving a service worker and it's running in the background. Okay. Let's add the next event, the activate event. So self.addEventListener. Activate. It received a callback. Okay, and let's console log something. Console log. Service worker activated. Okay, let's reload the page. And because of the service worker was activated before, it doesn't need to be activated again. So in order for the message activated to be prompt, we just need to skip the waiting to be activated. This is because the service workers are installed but not activated on runtime, because in order to this service worker to be activated, I'll need to close the page or click here, skip wait. So if I click here, you can see that the service worker was activated. Okay. So let's add some offline functionality. Some applications have custom offline pages. Whenever you access to a page and you don't have internet, you don't see an error. You see a custom offline page. So in order to do this, add event listener, we're going to listen to the fetch event. Okay. And then let's just console log what does this looks like. Console.log event.request. Inside the event object, we have a request property. We can check that. Let me reload the page and activate our service worker. Okay, now it's activated. Let's reload again the page. Now you can see these are all the fetches that my application is doing. So we are requesting JavaScript files or HTML, even CSS files. So first, we'll need to cache our offline page because we are only retrieving the offline page whenever we don't have internet connection. And in order to retrieve the page, we'll need first to have it locally. So in order to do this, we use inside the event object in the install event, we have access to a method called wait until, okay? The wait until method will wait until the function it received terminate in order to continue. So we want to use the caches property and the open method. This open method receives a string. This is the name of the cache we want to open or create. So let me call static, okay? And then we receive a promise. Let's call it cache. And then just let's add our offline page. So cache.add, and the file it's offline. So let's click offline.html. Okay, let's reload the page. Let's clear the console, activate our service worker. And if I go to my cache, you can see that our offline page was cached. So here it's a bit small, but you can see that it's an HTML file. Now we want to retrieve this file every time that the internet connection fails, okay? So in order to do this, inside the event method on the fetch event, we have the method respond with. This method returns a response for each request. So first of all, we want to fetch the request. So we use the fetch API and make the request, okay? If the request is successful, let me just give an enter here. Okay, if the request is successful, we just want to return the response, pretty simple. But if there is a problem on retrieving that information, we want to retrieve something from our cache, okay? So in order to do this, we open a cache block and return our cache. So let's open our cache, open. The name is static because we created here. So static cache. And then having open our cache, we look for our file, but first, we want just to return our offline page if the browser is reaching for HTML files, because we don't want to return this offline page for all the requests for a request for a JavaScript file or a CSS file. So in order to do this, we just check if the request the event.request.url it's equal to our home page. So let's say this, okay? If this is correct, it's because we're retrieving only the home page. So we return inside our cache, we match a key. The key is the path here. It's offline. So we offline.html, okay? And then we return the response. So let's return the response, okay? And if this doesn't happen, so we return else, return cache.match event.request. And then return the response. Okay, let's now reload our page. Okay, let me see. Yep, let me skip waiting to activate the service worker, reload the page again. And if I go offline and reload our page, you can see that our custom offline page is showing, even though we don't have internet. This is because we're retrieving this file from our cache. Okay. This is the most simple way of adding some offline functionality. Right now, we are going. Now, let's erase this and add complete offline functionality. So, in order to do this, we're going to cache more data, and our application will be still working even though there is no internet. So, okay, so on the fetch event, we are going to change a bit the logic. So, first, we want to open our cache and match the request. So, request event dot request. Okay. Then, we want to return the response. Okay, return response. But if the response from our cache is empty because there isn't there, we might want to have make a fetch request. So fetch event dot request, and then this response we want to first store this response. So let me just give some space here in order to be easier to read. Okay, then with the response we want to store this data. So caches dot open, because the data we are storing is dynamic data, because it's the data that we are fetching from the page. We want to store it on a different cache, so let's call it dynamic cache. And then with the cache object, which this promise returns, we just put this new data. So put is another keyword. It's different from cache.add because it receives two parameters. The first one is the key. So let request.url will be the key, and the value will be our response from the fetch event. So res. And because the response from a fetch promise can only be read once, we are going to call a method called clone. And then we return the response. Okay. So let's reload the page. You can see that everything is working as expected. Let me activate the service worker. Reload the page. Okay. You can see that we have some errors. Okay. Let me check my network because sometimes, okay, application. Let's check our cache. You can see that the dynamic cache is caching everything. Okay, let's reload the promise and let's see. Fail to execute put on cache, okay. We have some problem here. Maybe let me clear this. Running the response, okay. So, okay, this is because we are not returning anything from the fetch. So we're going to return cache. Okay, let's reload the page, activate the service worker. Okay, now it's working, as you can see. Always remember to return something from, okay, let's, as I was saying, always remember to return something from your promises, because if you don't, will respond with empty data for all the requests. So that was the problem. Okay, now if I go offline and reload my page, you can see that my page is still working, but we have an error. This error is because we're trying to save some Chrome extension data on our cache, and we are not allowed to do this. In order to get rid of this problem, we just catch the error Return an empty function. That will do. Okay, let's activate the new service worker. Okay, and reload the page, and you can see that the error is gone. Let me go online again, reload my page. And now, if I go offline, reload the page, you can see that our application is still working. But what happened if I click on one of these buttons? Each of these buttons will make a request to our server. If I click here, you can see that we have a problem to fetch. This is because we didn't visit these two buttons whenever we have internet. So the information there wasn't cached. So if I go online again and then visit here and here, and now go offline, you can see that now this is working fine as expected because we already visited this page whenever when we have internet connection, and our service worker handled this and cached all the information. Okay. Now, another thing is very interesting from service workers is that you can sync actions to your backend, even if the action was made when your internet connection was offline. So here, I have here a submit email where I can put an email, for example, jose.jobcity.io. If I submit this email, okay, this is because we are in offline again. Okay, let me reload the page. Okay, jobcity.io. If I send and I check my backend, you can see that request was sent to by our backend. But if we are offline, this request is not going to reach our backend because the application is not sending anything because it doesn't have internet connection. So in order to fix this, let's get rid of our fetch event because we don't want to intercept any of these requests, because we're going to use another thing called the sync API. In order to do this, we have to check if our service worker supports, if our browser supports the sync manager. So let's add another if statement. Okay, if sync manager in the window object. Okay, if this is true, so we add access to our service worker. So navigator.serviceworker.ready. This is a promise just to check if the service worker is already registered and installed and activated. This returns a promise with our service worker. And then we can call some methods inside our service worker. We're going to call the sync method, and the register method inside sync. So the register method inside sync, it receives a parameter. It's a string. This is the tag name of the sync event. So let's call it the sync emails. Okay. And let's just console.log sync email register. Now, if I reload my page, go online again, reload my page, activate our service worker. Okay, you can see that our sync email is registered. Okay, now we just have to listen to this event. So self.addEventListener. Okay, we want to listen to the sync event. This returns an object. We're going to call it event. Okay, and we are going to check if the tag name we provided is the same tag we want to listen. So if event.tag, it's equal to the same name we provide. So let's check it. Okay, sync email. And let's just console log something. Console.log sync email triggered. Okay, let's reload the page. Activate our new service worker. Okay, reload the page again, you can see that the sync email was triggered. This is because we are registering the page, this tag every time we reload the page. Okay, we can also trigger this event using the debug console. Here you can see that I already have the key sync email. If I go and click sync, you can see that the sync email was triggered again. See? Okay. Now, what we want to do is somehow store the emails that couldn't be sent to the backend in a database. I already built a script for this. Here, you can see that this is the function that makes this happen. So first, we try to return send our email to our backend, but if it fails, we just store the email on a local database. For example, if I go offline and write some tests, you can see that the error was sent. And you can see here that these are the tests that emails I sent whenever we were offline. So now, and then you can see that I also registered again the event tag. This is because we are calling this event whenever we add something to our backend. Now, if I go and click, let me clear the console, go offline again, you can see that sync email was triggered. This is because we registered when the method that we call the sync method registered and call it called by its name. And because the data couldn't be processed, the browser stored this request and then tried to send it. So now we just need to here in the if statement trigger something in order to send the data from our database to our backend. And I already built a script for that. So let's just import the scripts that I need. So in order to do this, we're going to use the import script method, import scripts. Okay, this receives the script names. So I just need my library. And I use this library to access some functionalities from the IndexedDB. And also what I need is the IndexedDB script, in order to use this function. This function is the one that checks for emails on our database and send it to the backend and then clear the database. So let's just import also this script. So scripts slash dot. Yes. Now with that, we have access to these functions, because as I told you, service worker doesn't have access to the DOM. But with this import script, we have access to all the functions that the script you are importing to. So now we just need to call this functionality, this function inside our event. Okay. And also you need to use the wait until, because we want to wait until the event, this function finish to process in order to return it. So event dot wait until. Okay, and this receives a function. Okay. Now, if I reload the page, I'm all online. Okay. Okay, let's activate our service worker, clean our, okay. Reload the page again. And let's trigger the sync event. So let's trigger the sync event. And you can see emails up to date. This is because whenever we send information to the backend and there is nothing else, we console log emails up to date. So if I go to my backend and reload, you can see that our backend is now synchronized with the data that couldn't be processed. So let's make another test. Let's go offline again. Let's check our database, reload this, it's empty. and add our another email. So let's say jose.google.com at google.com. Okay, submit. You can see that it was stored to our index.db. And then if I go online again and reload our page, you can see that jose.google was stored on our backend. That's the core functionality from a service worker, as you can see. We have plenty, it can be used for many ways. And that's it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you Jose so much for your presentation. It was really awesome, and thank you so much all the people who can join. It was a really great experience for us, and it seems that we don't have any question yet. Does someone in the chat have a question? You can post it and Jose can answer it. So I have a question, Jose. Just a quick one. So this technology is actually, I mean, service workers is actually viable on any GS framework, right?
Right. As you can see, I used plain JavaScript in order to make the demo. And because of this, it's very easy to use it on the most popular frameworks like Angular, React, or Vue. I'm aware that with Angular, there are some plugins that you need to install and load first your service worker. Also in React, you just need to register it on the app.js file, and it will work as expected. Just like the plain notification, the plain JavaScript version of this.
Yeah, and this didn't mess with any of the JavaScript lifecycle specific in every framework.
No, because the service worker is running on a different thread. This so a single, even if I open multiple tabs of the same application, a single service worker will be managing all these applications. So it's a completely different thread, and it will continue being alive even if you close the applications.
Thank you, Jose, for your answer. I understand.
Okay.
So it seems that we don't have any other questions, but thank you, Jose, again for this amazing presentation, and thank you all guys for being available to join us. And I hope to see you next month. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.